I was just making sure with Rachel if it's just one verse for the day, and thank you, Steve. It's Mark 11, verse 24. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours.
Good morning to everyone. Hey, they're alive. Very good, very good. I had like five different people ask me, is it just one verse? Is it really just one verse? But isn't that a pretty packed, cool verse? I mean, if you're going to choose one, that's a pretty good one, yeah? And it really is enough. I'm super excited today to be talking about prayer. It is so amazing. And I mean, there's this nice, thank you so much for the worship, Ben and Steph and Kezia is so beautiful. And it was very peaceful, wasn't it? And quiet and reverent. And there's a certain reverence and heaviness in the whole service today so far, but which is in one sense appropriate when you're talking about prayer. But I also just want to highlight that prayer is exhilaratingly exciting, that the creator of the universe has given us a channel for us to engage with said creator. I mean, come on, right? We don't get to engage with the prime minister or you know, top presidents or what have you, but the creator of all things we can chat with. I mean, that's crazy cool. And there's a somberness to that, but there's an energy and exhilaration to that. Before we dive into the specific discussion on prayer, I just want to step back and talk a little bit also about this general series that we're going through right now. It's been a couple of weeks that we started this series off, and I just wanted to prove it to be very effective in getting deeper into our relationship with God. And though they have been tried and proven by these spiritual giants, the cool thing is they're accessible to like the regular dudes like us, right? And they aren't incredibly difficult. They aren't multi-complex kind of things. They just require a little bit of work, a little bit of attention, and yes, discipline by definition, right? And I'll underscore with you guys, the word disciple sounds a lot like discipline, doesn't it? Right? It is the same root. And it's a core part of our journey and walk with God. And to do this, we're going through a book that I know both Vivek and Ben mentioned called The Celebration of Discipline, which is a lovely book because it very easily goes through these various different disciplines in a way that's not too like dense and heavy. It's pretty accessible. And one thing that I really like in the way that the author highlighted the requirement or the need to get on this path is that what he mentions is that the curse of our day today is superficiality, right? We are plagued by a world that wants to operate at a very shallow depth, right? And the themes of the day are instant satisfaction, instant gratification, and immense distraction. Right? And you can just see how, and this is backed up by science, right? People know what a dopamine hit does to us, right? How that addicts us, how that keeps us coming back for more. And so as technology and science has improved in these areas, you've seen the kind of offerings that we get laid in front of us are offerings that prey on that and play on that, right? And so short form, you know, our attention span is now defined in 15-second clips and that produce that hit, and then we keep coming back for more. In this kind of a setting, what the world tells us, you know, generally is that, the real heroes are the super smart people, the super creative people, the good-looking people, the talented people. What the world really needs today are deeper people. People that operate at a level of depth that goes under the superficiality that plagues the world. And even though people get addicted to this superficiality, I will tell you, deep down inside, they appreciate the depth. But a lot about this celebration of discipline is that we've kind of lost even the knowledge and the wherewithal and the habit to get into that depth. Come and we'll go through the motions and we'll leave, right? And so this whole exercise is to kind of help us to get these disciplines and to try and move into those depths where you enter into a richness, you feel the hug of the creator of the universe around you and guiding you in every decision you make and every thought you have and every action you take in the world. And so what I want to be sure that we recognize is in these disciplines, you don't want to fall into these traps. This isn't like us taking charge of our faith for God and a recipe where we're going to work our way into a good faith. It's not works, right? These are not laws that we're going to get beat up if we're not practicing meditation and prayer and fasting and whatever. They're not laws. The Bible warns us about both of these things, right? And the other two, explore these depths a bit, yeah? Fair enough? Anyone have any questions or protests on the spiritual discipline approach? Okay. So Ben took us through last week a discussion on meditation. And really what we're covering today as prayer is quite interesting because it's really the sister of meditation. And if meditation is about, in this cluttered, noisy, distracting world, trying to create a certain amount of space, a certain amount of quietness, and a certain mindset to be receptive to receiving what God wants to give us and to be able to hear God's quiet voice amidst all that noise. If that is meditation, summarizing it, prayer is building on that and on top of that, taking it to a level of us engaging God, us becoming into a point where we're in perpetual communion with God and we're interacting and conversing with God. And I think it is fair to say that there is no discipline that is more central to our walk with God than prayer. It is a conversation with the Creator. And it is what activates the meditation, the fasting, the study, all of the other disciplines, the way God often speaks to us and us to God, and the wrestling that we have is through prayer. And as such, it should be given a serious amount is almost equivalent to change. A real prayer life is a life that is creating life in us, creating life in the world, but it is changing our lives, and it is changing other people's lives. So prayer is this dynamic thing that it's, you can almost say that prayer is change for us and for those that we touch. And through prayer and through God, we can touch anyone, anywhere on the planet. This kind of change is about not just us requesting of God things, but it's that we begin to open ourselves so that the things that we request of God, the things we want God to do, begin to change. So that it's, I begin to desire what God desires. I want to love what God loves. I want to live how God has shown us to live. That's what I mean by this change. It's something that will happen over time if we have a healthy prayer life. And I know that some of you guys have experienced this. I've had moments in prayer where it was such an aha about something that was wrong in my life or a direction in an incorrect direction that I was heading. And it was just all of a sudden like a veil had been lifted. It became so clear through a prayer. Imagine, and that has led me to change the course of my life at times and to make very dramatic steps. Now imagine that I didn't create that access point. Where would I be today? Maybe some of you guys have felt this as well, right? Change is a part at the core of prayer. I would say the other big piece here of prayer is that it is, in essence, faith, right? If we don't believe in God, why would we ever pray, right? There's no one to talk to. But that's not just that's a surface kind of level, because we've talked before about, you know, believing that a God exists, that's a certain kind of faith. But believing that that God loves and cares and listens and responds, that's a different kind of faith. That's a trust kind of faith. And if I begin to ask God for things and expect answers to these prayers, and if I begin to put my life and turn my life over to God, that's a different, deeper level kind of faith. And so at the core of prayer, I would highlight for us today to reflect on is change, and it is faith, Trinity. Even Jesus prayed consistently, and if I'll just highlight a few points, but please, the next time you're reading through the Gospels, just note how often it mentions Jesus praying. To highlight a few points, at Jesus' baptism, if you want to look in Luke 3:21, in his baptism, right? He prays even as he's being baptized. As in Luke 6:21, the night before he's going to call his disciples, when he's starting his ministry, he stays up all night praying. Did you guys ever notice that before? All night he stays up praying because it was so important. He's going to recruit the team, right? Luke 9:29, during his transformation, when the disciples see him taking another form, was he just like checking his texts when he took that form? No, he was praying. He was praying when he got so transformed and transfigured. You know the story, I talk about it often, is one of my favorites, of this father who brings his son that was possessed. And the disciples tried and couldn't fix this situation, right? And then Jesus heals the boy. And later the disciples asked, you know, why couldn't we do this? What happened? What did he say? This requires prayer. So we see that even the disciples had kind of a substandard prayer life, right? They thought, oh, we could do this. He highlights prayer there. And of course, one of the most intense prayers we've seen in the Bible is in Gethsemane, in the garden, right? And there you see even Jesus wrestling with the Father. Even Jesus saying, is this really what needs to be done? Is there another way? So I think that highlights a little bit of the spectrum quickly in the range. There are prayers of seeking guidance. There are prayers of faith and intercession. There are prayers of repentance, of gratitude, all flavors. We're going to focus on a couple today. But before we go any further, I'd like us to go ahead and break up into groups. It's cafe style today, and where there's a few questions. And I know that for those of you that attend home groups, there is a bit of discussion on Friday or Thursday, whenever you meet with your group. Hopefully these questions are a little bit different and can prompt a little bit of a discussion. And so we'll do that for a little time and then sit next to the people you came with. And that could be a productive way to do the group. Usually we're doing some, you know, social engineering of 1, 2, 3, 4. But why don't we just, you know, kind of generally the facilitators, if you could raise your hand. Yeah. So, Steph, if you could just kind of take front right, Rachel, right back. Arpit, you can be here, and Eric over there. And so if you guys can have the maturity to form equally sized groups and not leave anyone alone, that would be awesome. Okay, very good. I apologize for cutting off anyone who's still going there, but trying to be mindful of the time. And some very advanced groups finished up, you know, long ago. We have some investigation going on whether they were following the superficial route or getting as deep as the others. You know, we can. No, just kidding. I'd love to hear, you can kind of stay in your group somewhat here before you disband too much, but maybe group by group, we don't need to get a full summary, but if anyone, we'll start with the advanced early finishers in the right corner back there. Does anyone, from any of the three questions, is there any aha, conclusion, or reflection that you would want to share with the rest of the service?
I think a lot of us agreed that what is even the point of prayer? I know that's a bit harsh, but we came to the conclusion that sometimes we could be praying without knowing what the outcome would be. So what is even the point of prayer? Because it could lead to us being fearful or even us not wanting to pray at all for fear of the answer. Mm. You know, so that was something that, yeah, that came out of our discussion. I don't know if that's where you were heading to, but yeah.
No, it doesn't matter where I want to head this. You take it where you guys took it. That's good.
Okay, yeah, sure. We're the advanced group, so yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Cool.
Anything else you guys wanted to share back there? Anyone else? Okay, very good. Yeah, thank you for sharing that, Rachel. That's great. We'll touch on that. How about up here, up front? Anything you guys would want to share?
Yeah, I mean, I think for us, we were just talking about how it is such a moment to hear from him and to break the monotony in our lives of just, we fill it with so many different things, but he wants to direct all of it, every single thing. And so the more that we come to him, the more he wants to direct our lives. And so that's that first part of what changes. It's that it's supposed to change us. Mm. You know, and so if we let it, we will live such a wonderful life of just knowing how to go to him, how to hear him, how to trust him more. So that's, so we just ended up praying and giving that to him as well.
Amen.
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you. The middle group, anyone want to share anything there? It need not be the official facilitator, though. That is awesome if it is.
I think we discussed quite a lot of stuff. I'm just going to speak about a few things that are still in my heart. I think one of the things that we did discuss was the change that prayer brings is specifically with respect to perspectives. And something very interesting that we shared was to pray also you need to change. You need to bring in small changes into your life to make time for prayer. So it's not only prayer changes you for sure, but you also need to change to have a decent time of prayer. And I think the last question was really nice, where we discussed what kind of, how would your life change if we had a good prayer life or a healthy prayer life? And the ones of us who did speak, what we did speak about is the fact that if we did have a good prayer life, it would involve submission, surrender, and possibly things that we're not very comfortable with. But yeah, I guess that's how it would change our lives. Prayer would help us surrender to His will and understand the fact that we might not get what we pray for, but we will learn to submit to Him, to His will.
Awesome. Thank you. And you guys over here in the front, anyone?
Yay. As you can see, there were many, many thoughts that nobody really wanted to try and summarize it. I think one thing that stood out is that what prayer looks like for everyone is so different. There is no sort of formula to it. I think the responses of what does it do and why is it important is that how it changes you can be slow. It's not necessarily in the direction you might want it to change you in. And it can be in the little things in the everyday that you pray and not necessarily just a specific time. And I think that idea of how most of us seem to have been taught was that prayer life looks a certain way, but in our own experiences, it doesn't actually look like that. But in the last piece of How Would It Change, I think there was a decrease in worry, submission of ourselves, surrender of identity, and yeah, just recognizing sometimes we don't actually have any plans. Yeah. Anything else?
Great, thank you. From the online one, yeah, Priya, you want to? Yeah, from anyone from the online group want to share any reflections or thoughts from the discussion? Any of the questions? Okay, fair enough. Fair enough. If they're being shy, Priya. Yeah, John has the mic.
So I think what I'll just share about is that last question. And it was interesting because we had different responses. So one person said that they definitely, when they have that prayer time in the morning, they can see a difference during the day. So for example, if there's a confrontation, that person might respond rather than react. So they've observed things. And that's just an example. So they have observed that during the day there is a difference. Between a day maybe when they've had that time to pray and when they haven't. Another person said that they pray, sometimes they don't get that time in the morning to set aside, so they do small prayers throughout the day. And because of that, God's, you know, that presence of God, they're constantly reminded and they're always going into the presence of God. And that is a difference between a day when maybe they don't, haven't had that time to do it. And that also brings about change. And I think I shared that I can't relate, like, I've never looked at a day and said, oh, I prayed today and therefore I didn't react but responded, to be honest. I think there are days when I've prayed and I've still reacted. There are days when I haven't prayed in the morning and I've responded rather than not reacted. But I think for me it's gradual change over a period of time. And if there's a period of time where I haven't had that time to pray, I can see the change in me. It's for the negative. Whereas if I have spent that time in prayer over a period of time, I can see changes in me. So I think those are the things that we just discussed with that last question.
Very cool. Awesome. Thank you, guys. Thanks for sharing. And I think some great reflections there and very interesting and appropriate to hear about the appropriate level of, you know, kind of fear of what engaging in praying like this might imply. I think that's accurate. We should be afraid, right? We should be worried on some level, on a very human level. On the other hand, we know that the God that made us, that designed us, that created us with a purpose is not going to move us in a direction that is counter to that design. It just might not be what our human side wants or thinks we want or need at the top. And that's a scary thing that again comes back to that point of faith. I believe this God exists. Do I trust this God with my life, with my career, with where I live, with who I'm hanging out with? Or do I want to maintain a certain level of control? And when we get in dialogue with the Creator, we might feel the pinch that we're not where we should be, and that might be uncomfortable, right? And here I want to highlight, because we touched on a couple of different points around very practical things, the time and the amount of time and what have you, and I want to encourage you guys to think on a couple different levels. One basic bedrock type of prayer is the prayer of guidance. And that is your basic relationship with God kind of prayer. And I would encourage all of you that this is the prayer that is kind of the launch pad for every other prayer and really the launch pad for our growth. And it merits a certain amount of space and time and discipline, very akin to the meditation. And it might even be paired with that same meditation time. But I would encourage you guys to think about in the structure of your life where, when, and how you could set aside this appropriate time and space. And I would say 10 minutes as you're rushing out the door, probably not adequate for this kind of prayer. right? I pray in the shower, right? But that's not adequate for this kind of prayer. That's like some of the daily stuff and everything like that, right? I'll pray on the way to work. I'll pray before a meeting, right? I go in early to the office, and sometimes I'll pray over at desk where I know that dude needs prayer, you know, one of my team members or what have you. But that's not this kind of a prayer, right? Those flash prayers are amazing, and it tells us in Thessalonians, pray without ceasing, without stopping. So what's very interesting, oh, I'll come to that, but let's this guidance prayer. What I would encourage you guys here is there is a recipe for prayer, right? We covered it in the groups. The Lord's Prayer is not just that specific prayer, but it's also a structure in that prayer that's guiding us on how to structure our prayer time. But each one of us is wired a little differently. I think some people might be able to get up super early in the morning when everything's quiet, and that's a great time to dedicate a big chunky space. I know there are other nocturnal beings that would find that like crippling on their life, right, to get up early. And so they're going to be more of a late night person or what have you. So and overall, I think I would go so far as to say there are different levels of prayer, right? And it can be a bad prayer, and you could be a great prayer. And it's not just your style. It's on an absolute scale. And it might be controversial, but I say that because prayer is something we should practice. If we just do it once, if we do it half-heartedly, we will not be good at it, right? It's not to say that God won't speak to us, but really to engage, really to make ourselves available to God and to reveal our heart to God and to hear God speaking, we should practice. We should figure out how do we, in our nature, best dial in to God and get attuned to God. Right? And it might be that if we don't feel like prayer is impacting us or our prayers aren't being answered, it might be that we're not finding the right recipe. So I would encourage you guys, and it might be even interesting, the reflection of that Priya shared, treat it like science. Do a sample. Pray for a day and see if it's different. And then don't pray for a day and see if that day is different. Chart it. But approach prayer like with a troubleshooting kind of attitude. How do I get better at prayer? And devote that time to it. And I would put a challenge to you guys. Well, first of all, how many of you guys think you're at expert level prayer warrior quality? Is anyone elite in here in prayer? I'm certainly not. Yeah, Kezia, you're elite. Awesome. Yeah. For the rest of us humans, we have room to grow, right? Now, who here is elite in social media consumption? Anyone? Yeah, we've got some hands, right? So I would challenge you guys that for your guidance prayer, why don't you discipline yourself to a 1:1 ratio? I don't want to limit your social media activity. I just want you to match it with prayer time, right? So if you're going to watch a video or a movie or 1,000 TikTok clips or whatever, just keep track of that time and pray that same amount in that day, right? Do you think we could do that? No? Yeah. It's kind of a good metric because it'll help us reduce the social media and increase the praying. So it has a double whammy. And we kind of joke, but I would very much encourage you, if you come back to that last question, if you think that having deeper engagement in prayer with God would positively change your life, why wouldn't you devote more effort and time to it? And I will challenge you again, if you think social media is helping you become a better person, right? Maybe slightly on the margins. God can work through anything. But I don't think there's a good comparison between these two. So that's my challenge to you. If you can work, maybe 1:1 is too much at the start, but maybe 2:1, set some ratio that gives you a little discipline and forces you to engage like this with God. And take this approach of back and forth, of dialing in on your right recipe. One thing, for example, is you might need to add more imagination to your prayer. Some people, by visualizing. And so you're not just praying for a person that needs a prayer for health, but you're imagining God coming over and touching. You're visualizing Christ praying over that person and touching that person. That might make you a more effective prayer, right? And so work with it. Push the boundaries. Explore how can I best connect and engage with God. But this is serious business. The other thing I would say is these other kinds of prayers are more like a faith or intercession prayer, where you're making a specific request. You're asking for something of God, right? And there, we need to pray in faith. How many times have you guys heard this prayer? If it be your will, God. Right? What is that? Is that a cop-out? Is that us being insecure about our faith? Is that like a little protection in case this prayer doesn't get answered? I want to have a little background. It must have not been God's will that there wasn't a total genocide in some place. Do you think that there's any question about God's will? Right? Maybe we're lacking faith. And so maybe we need to pray. When you see some of the prayers in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, I can tell you in the health prayers, not a one was if it's your will. The one where is if it's your will is the garden. I want out of this. That's what I want, but I really want to do what you want. That's where we co-opted that piece. But with the healings, with all that stuff, it's like, God, take this demon out. God, heal this person. There's no question. There's faith, right? And these prayers can be sprinkled throughout, right? This asking on someone's behalf. You're on that Zoom call waiting for it to get live. Why don't you pray for the people on that call? Why don't you pray that God will be glorified in that call rather than, I hope my project's accepted, or I hope I... And I'll tell you, this is one of the most transforming things that has happened to me in the last couple years is I used to pray for my company to do well, right? And to the point of how God changes us, I don't pray like that anymore. I say, God, will you be glorified through my company? And if God's glorified by my company spectacularly failing, praise God. That's going to hurt. It's going to hurt my pride, my ego, my finances. Like, it's going to be horrible. But I want that. That's my little garden, much less intense, right, than what Jesus had. And yet when I prayed for my daughter, who was really struggling and going through a horrible time, that was not a if it be your will. That's this. I know you want this, and I believe you can make it happen. Right? And it happened. And I have a history of things being honored in prayer. My mom was healed of cancer this last year. My daughter came back from a horrible situation. And yet still, knucklehead, I lack the faith to pray with that kind of confidence. Right? So I need to work on that. I think a lot of us at times need to work on that. But aside from faith, I'd also encourage you, sometimes it's not faith, but it's our own compassion that is the missing ingredient. If you look in the Bible, I've talked about this before, most of the healing, the feeding, all the miracles that happen are preceded by compassion, right? And he felt compassion for them and he fed them. And he felt compassion for them and he taught them. And he felt compassion and he healed her, right? And the same thing goes for us when we're praying. If we aren't hurting for the people that we're praying for, then maybe that's part of this faith formula, right? That is certainly part of having God's heart. We should feel that. We should have that passion. And what's awesome about that, it's kind of a circular thing, because if you have an incredible compassion for others, you will want for them way more than you can give them with your limited set of talents and resources and responsibility, and you will find yourself, there's nothing left but to pray. Because I cannot deliver as much as I'd want to deliver to this person I love, this person that I'm passionate about, that I have compassion for. And therefore, God, help me. God, you provide, right? And so that compassion will drive us to a more desperate, to a more faithful, to a more persistent kind of prayer as well. So, if we pray like this, one thing I can guarantee you, and I've not maximized it, but for the sliver that I've been successful on it, to the last question, I can guarantee you that your life will change with better prayer, for the better, without a doubt. It might be something that today you see as scary, but on the other side of it, you'll be grateful, right? From this side, things look scary. You get on the other side, you're like, why was I afraid? Why did I resist that? It's so much better over here, right? I can absolutely guarantee you, not any ounce of doubt in my mind, that a more intense and full kind of prayer life will make every aspect of your life better. And I would add that that's family and that's this community here. A measure of a strong faith community, a church, needs to be on a foundation of prayer. And I think we haven't, though I love this community and where we are and what we've done, we're nowhere close to the potential that we should have even at this stage because I don't think we've been on our knees enough, right? And the only way this place is going to be what it should be as an instrument of God is if we're all praying for this community and the people that come through the doors. So I lift that up for you guys to reflect on, to reflect on these deeper things, but the practical points and this idea of practicing and troubleshooting and trying and failing and dialing in on your right prayer recipe. And so with that, if you'll join me in prayer, and then we'll close with a worship song. Father God, we thank you that though you are so great and powerful and omniscient and the God of the world, that you give us access to you, that you take the time to know us and to speak to us, and even more importantly, to hear us, God. And I thank you that we see examples in the Bible of people who pray to you and actually change your heart, God, through their prayer. And Father, I just pray that you would guide us and help us, each one of us, to figure out what is the best way to create this space to be with you, to reveal our heart to you, and even to wrestle with you, God. I pray that through this, you would help us to grow closer into the people that you made us to be, and that you would help us touch this world in the way that you want it touched, God. We lift up to you our inner lives and our physical lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Mm-hmm.